High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Triumph of Injustice, How the Rich Dodge Taxes and How to Make Them Pay, by Emmanuel, Saez, and Gabriel Zucman. Read by Steve Menasche. Introduction. Reinventing Fiscal Democracy. The evening of September 26, 2016, was off to a good start for Hillary Clinton. The former Secretary of State had the upper hand in her first election debate against Donald Trump, the reality show celebrity who had won the Republican primary. Nervous and aggressive, the GOP candidate kept interrupting his opponent. The Democratic candidate, well-prepared and relaxed, kept scoring points. When suddenly the debate turned to taxes. Breaking with a tradition dating back to the early 1970s, Trump had refused to release his tax returns, claiming he was prevented by an ongoing audit from the Internal Revenue Service. Clinton baited the billionaire real estate developer into talking about how little he had paid over the years. The only tax returns that anybody's seen was when he was trying to get a casino license, and they showed he didn't pay any federal income tax. Trump proudly admitted to it. That makes me smart. Clinton did not snap back. A dispassionate exposition of the well-crafted, carefully weighted, thoughtful technocratic fixes she had envisioned for the nation's tax code would not have carried the day. Politically, that makes me smart was a shrewd line. That one of the country's wealthiest men could, by his own admission, pay no tax at all was so absurd that it reinforced the central narrative of the Trump campaign. The Washington, D.C. establishment had failed the country. The tax code, like everything else, was rigged. In Trump's answer, there was an echo of President Ronald Reagan himself, who famously compared the tax code to daily mugging. In both Trump's and Reagan's views, the relentless pursuit of self-interest supports the prosperity of all. Capitalism harnesses human greed for the greater good. Taxes are a hindrance, and avoiding them is the right thing to do. At the same time, That Makes Me Smart exposed the paradox of this ideology. Relentless self-interest destroys the norms of trust and cooperation at the heart of any prosperous society. Trump himself would be nothing without the infrastructure that connects his skyscrapers to the rest of the world, the sewer system that carries their waste, the teachers who taught his lawyers how to read, the doctors and the public research that keep him healthy, let alone the laws and courts that protect his property. What makes communities thrive is not any unfettered free-for-all. It is the cooperation and collective action. Without taxes, there is no cooperation, no prosperity, no common destiny. There is not even a nation in need of a president. Trump's boast revealed a failure of American society. It had become so natural that the affluent do not contribute to the public coffers that a candidate for the presidency would openly admit to it while his opponent offered no clear solution in response. The country's tax system, the most important institution of any democratic society, had failed. We wrote this book with two objectives in mind. The first, to understand how exactly the United States got into this mess. The second, to help fix it. The Triumph of Injustice. Candidate Trump's admission was only anecdotal evidence of a new injustice in America. Even as their incomes boomed, as they reaped the rewards from globalization, and their wealth skyrocketed to previously unseen heights, the most fortunate Americans have seen their tax rates fall. Meanwhile, for the working class, wages stagnated, work conditions deteriorated, debts ballooned, and taxes rose. Since 1980, the tax system has enriched the winners in the market economy and impoverished those who realized few rewards from economic growth. Any democracy must debate the proper size of government and the ideal degree of tax progressivity. Informed by history and international experience, by statistics and abstract reasoning, it is natural for individuals and countries alike to sometimes change views. But have the tax policy changes of the last decades been the result of such an informed deliberation? Has the collapse in taxes for the ultra-rich reflected what Americans as a society wanted? We doubt it. Some of these changes were the result of conscious choices, but many more have been born passively. The outbreak of a tax avoidance industry that obscures income and wealth. The emergence, with globalization, of new loopholes exploited by multinational companies. The spiral of international tax competition that has led countries to slash their tax rates one after another. Most of the changes in taxation are not due to a sudden popular appetite for exempting the wealthy, but to forces that have prevailed without input from voters. Whether or not tax cuts can have positive economic effects, the upheavals of the last decades are not, by and large, the product of rational choices deliberated on and made by an informed citizenry. The triumph of tax injustice is, above all, a denial of democracy. The first contribution of this book is to tell the story of this great transformation. Our story is not one of left versus right. It is not about the triumph of small government conservatives over spread-the-wealth liberals. It is the story of how the tax system established by the New Deal was undermined. At each step of its demise, we find the same pattern. It starts with an outburst of tax avoidance. It continues with policymakers letting this tax avoidance fester, paralyzed by supposedly invisible foes, tax shelters, globalization, tax havens, financial opacity. And it ends with governments slashing the tax rates of the wealthy under the pretense that taxing the richest among us has become impossible. To understand this injustice and which choices and non-choices have contributed to its triumph, we have undertaken an in-depth economic investigation. Drawing on a century of statistics, we have estimated how much each social group, from the poorest up to billionaires, has paid in tax since 1913 in the United States. Our data series include all taxes paid to the federal, state, and local governments. The federal income tax, of course, but also state income taxes, myriad sales and excise taxes, the corporate income tax, business and residential property taxes, and payroll taxes. The distinction between taxes paid by households and taxes paid by businesses is meaningless. All taxes are paid by people, and our work allocates all taxes to existing individuals over more than a century. Our approach is systematic. President Trump may brag that he does not pay much tax, but what about other rich people? Is Trump an anomaly or an example of a broader phenomenon? Individual cases can raise awareness, but however eye-popping, they cannot allow us to understand what's happening in society at large. To study the changes in taxation and their implications, we have methodically combined the available evidence in a consistent framework. Tabulations of income tax returns, results from tax audits, household survey data, reports on the profits booked by U.S. multinationals in their offshore subsidiaries, macroeconomic balance sheets, and national and international accounts. Economic statistics are never perfect. Ours have their limitations, which we will note in due course. But taken together, this combination of data unveils which choices, laws, and policies have fueled tax injustice. This comprehensive perspective, the fruits of years of research on the U.S. economy, allows us to study long-run changes in the progressivity of the U.S. tax system in its entirety, which no government agency or research institution has been able to do so far. The data reveal the scale of the changes that have occurred over recent decades, including, for the first time, the consequences of Donald Trump's presidency. Let's take a look. In 1970, the richest Americans paid, all taxes included, more than 50% of their income in taxes, twice as much as working-class individuals. In 2018, following the Trump tax reform, and for the first time in the last 100 years, billionaires have paid less than steelworkers, school teachers, and retirees. The wealthy have seen their taxes rolled back to levels last seen in the 1910s, when the government was only a quarter of the size it is today. It is as if a century of fiscal history has been erased. Global tax justice now. Beyond America, our story is more fundamentally about the future of globalization and the future of democracy. For although the changes in taxation have been extreme on this side of the Atlantic, the triumph of tax injustice is not specific to the United States. Most countries have, to a varying extent, seen inequality rise and tax progressivity fall in a context of rising tax avoidance and unfettered tax competition. The same questions bubble up throughout the world with the same urgency. If the taxes enacted by our elected officials keep boosting the income of a privileged minority, who will keep faith in democratic institutions? If globalization means ever lower taxes for its main winners and ever higher taxes for those it leaves out, who will keep faith in globalization? There is no time to lose. We must invent the new fiscal institutions and the new forms of cooperation that will help democracy and international openness flourish into the 21st century. The good news is that we can fix tax injustice right now. There is nothing inherent in globalization that destroys our ability to tax big companies and the wealthy. The choice is ours. We can let multinationals pick the country where they declare their profits, or we can pick for them. We can tolerate financial opacity and the countless possibilities of tax abuse that come with it, or we can choose to measure, record, and tax wealth. We can countenance a sprawling industry that helps the affluent dodge taxation, or we can choose to regulate it and weed out the supply of tax dodgers. It is possible to make globalization and progressive taxation compatible. The second contribution of this book is to demonstrate how. Many on both left and right are convinced that taxing multinational corporations is now nearly impossible. Try to tax them and they will relocate to Ireland, Singapore, or perhaps tomorrow, China. Their capital is intangible. It can move to Bermuda in a nanosecond. Other countries have low tax rates? We must have low rates. Other countries are giving up on taxing multinational companies and high earners? We must give up too. Tax coordination among countries is a utopia, and the only future is a race to the bottom. No matter how sincerely held they may be, no matter how widely shared, these beliefs are incorrect. Instead of engaging in a giant fiscal free-for-all, we can coordinate our policies, as we've successfully done in many other areas of international relations. Rest assured, we know that some countries and social groups derive large benefits from globalization in its current form, but other forms are possible. We will study in this book the arithmetic of tax competition and the central role it has played in the prosperity of a few. But we'll also see how a handful of countries acting together could whistle the end of this game. We will hear how defensive measures could be taken against tax havens, and how today's race to the bottom can be replaced by a race to the top. The notion that external or technical constraints, international competition, tax avoidance, loopholes, make tax justice idle fantasy does not withstand scrutiny. When it comes to the future of taxation, everything is possible. From the disappearance of the income tax, a plausible outcome if the trend of the last four decades is sustained, to levels of progressivity never seen before, there is an infinity of possible futures ahead of us. Democracy. Should billionaires pay 23% of their income in taxes, as they do in today's America, or closer to 50% as they did around 1970? Should corporate profits be taxed at 52% as in 1960, or at 21% as they have been since the 2018 tax reform? These questions will never be settled by data or science, and quite fortunately, they are not questions for economists. They are questions for all people, who should decide on them through democratic deliberation and the vote. Where economists can help is by assembling the information vital to a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It is by showing the multiplicity of possible paths and by describing these paths and their implications, how different distributions of taxes would affect each of us, and how the choices we make today will shape the growth of income for various social groups tomorrow. The third contribution of this book is to create a new tool that does just that. TaxJusticeNow.org is a simulation website that allows policymakers, activists, and all people, whatever their political stripe, school of thought, or knowledge about economics, to estimate the effect of tax policy changes on the distribution of taxes, the income and wealth of each social group, and the dynamics of inequality. The website allows anyone to assess how modifications of the parameters of the current tax system, as well as bolder reforms, would affect society. Would increasing the top marginal income tax rate to 70% suffice to make billionaires contribute more to the public coffers, all taxes included, than working-class Americans? What if we increased the corporate tax rate to 30% or created a new wealth tax on the super wealthy? By how much could taxes on the middle class be cut or the deficit reduced? These questions will always play an important role in the political debate. Yet there is currently no way for the public to obtain precise answers to them. Tax simulators exist within the U.S. Treasury, the Congressional Budget Office, and some think tanks, such as the Tax Policy Center and the Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy, but they are out of reach to journalists, candidates, and the broader electorate. In that context, most discussions about taxes end up quite vague. On the left, it's common to assert that the 1% owns so much wealth that sizable sums could be collected by taxing them more. This is true. But the assertion needs precision. How much revenue exactly could we expect to raise from increasing taxes on the affluent? Would it be enough to fund free public college education and health insurance for all? Among centrists, many lament existing tax loopholes in a steady drumbeat. If only we could plug these, no more changes would be necessary. Closing loopholes is important, but are we sure that it would make a real difference to the distribution of tax payments? On the right, orthodoxy dictates that combining all taxes, one can see that top marginal tax rates are already high. Adding additional levies would be punitive or hurt economic growth. Instead, the United States should introduce a consumption tax. Why not? But wouldn't such a tax system be even more regressive than today's? TaxJusticeNow.org provides factual answers to these questions based on a new economic approach. Our simulator includes all taxes at all levels of government, not only the income tax or federal taxes. It makes it possible to simulate fundamental innovations, such as introducing a progressive tax on wealth or a broad-based tax to fund health care for all. And while existing policy tools focus on the effect of tax changes on government revenues, ours shows their implications for a parameter that's too often missing from tax policy debates: inequality. We've all seen the headlines about the rise of income and wealth concentration in America, the surge at the top and the slow growth for the rest. It is real. The share of U.S. national income earned by the 1% has increased from 10% in 1980 to about 20% today. Will this trend continue? So much depends on what policies future governments will choose to implement, and especially on which tax policy will prevail. Under business as usual, income concentration is likely to keep rising in the medium run thanks to a snowball effect. The wealthy save a higher fraction of their income than the rest of the population, which allows them to accumulate more wealth, which in turn generates additional income. For most of the 20th century, progressive taxation, and especially high tax rates on capital, as opposed to labor, had kept this spiral under control. But the tax changes of the last two decades have dismantled this safeguard. To prevent inequality from reaching extreme levels, we will need to create a new tax system for the 21st century. Later in the book, we offer a slate of original and practical proposals to realize this transformation, from the taxation of extreme wealth to collecting from multinational companies, from the funding of healthcare to the reinvention of the progressive income tax. Our solutions are not perfect, nor are they the only possible answers. But they are precise, they are carefully scored, and we have thought hard about their implementation. Transparent, anybody can simulate their effect on the distribution of taxes and the dynamics of income and wealth for each social group, and supported by evidence and theory from modern research. Are these ideas for taming inequality realistic politically? It is easy to lose hope. Dark money in politics and self-serving ideologies are powerful foes. These problems are real, but we should not despair. Before injustice triumphed, the United States was a beacon of tax justice. It was the democracy with perhaps the most steeply progressive system of taxation on the planet. In the 1930s, U.S. policymakers invented, and then for almost half a century applied, top marginal income tax rates of 90% on the highest income earners. Corporate profits were taxed at 50%, large estates at close to 80%. With the revenue generated, the United States built the schools that made its people productive and prosperous, funding public universities that are still, to this day, the envy of the world. The history of taxation, as we'll see shortly, is full of U-turns. If it is any guide, smart billionaires who do not pay much tax today will not fool us forever. Chapter 1. Income and Taxes in America. How redistributive is America's tax system? For some observers, there's no doubt taxes in the United States are highly progressive. You owe more as a fraction of your income as you earn more. European countries rely a lot on value-added taxes, a levy on consumption which, since the rich save more, disproportionately hits the poor. But there is no value-added tax in America. Low earners, as the argument goes, thus must pay relatively little. At the top of the pyramid, the federal government has no qualms about making the rich pay the country's bills through its progressive income tax, according to this view. For many on the other side of the debate about tax progressivity, the truth is the opposite. The wealthy get off almost scot-free, by way of myriad loopholes in the tax laws and other legislated special interest breaks. Who's right? Before we can have a serene debate about policy, we must establish some basic facts about who really pays what. Unfortunately, government agencies, such as the Congressional Budget Office, in charge of informing Congress about budget and economic issues, do not provide the answer to that question, at least not fully. They publish information about the distribution of federal taxes, but disregard state and local taxes, which account for a third of all taxes paid by Americans and are much less progressive than federal levies. Their statistics do not provide specific information on the ultra-wealthy, so it's not possible to tell whether Donald Trump is an exception or an instance of a broader phenomenon among billionaires. Let's try to lift the fog. The average income of Americans, $75,000. Our investigation begins with a simple question. What is the average income of Americans today? To answer it, we must introduce a concept that will play a critical role in this book, national income. By definition, national income measures all the income that accrues to the residents of a given country in a given year, whatever legal form this income takes. It's the broadest possible concept of income. It's a figure larger in particular than the income reported on tax returns or recorded in household surveys. For instance, it includes all the profits made by corporations, whether or not those profits are distributed to shareholders. Like dividends, undistributed profits are a form of income for shareholders, the only difference being that this income is fully saved the year it is earned and reinvested in the firm. National income also includes all the fringe benefits, such as contributions to private health insurance, that workers get through their employers. National income is closely related to the more familiar concept of gross domestic product, avidly scrutinized in the media. GDP, as it is called, measures the value of all the goods and services that are produced in a given year. It's a concept that first emerged in the aftermath of the Great Depression and became popular in the 1950s and 1960s. Before that, the notion of national income prevailed. Today, however, the growth statistics that presidents and pundits like to comment upon always refer to the growth of GDP. In the United States, GDP per adult reached close to $90,000 in 2019. That is, the average adult produced goods and services worth $90,000. To get from GDP to national income requires two adjustments. First, you subtract capital depreciation, the loss in the value of buildings, machines, and equipment used during production that is an integral component of GDP, the reason why domestic product is gross. Depreciation does not correspond to any income for anybody. Before paying their workers, distributing dividends, and investing in new machines, businesses must first replace their worn-out equipment and other capital assets. Tractors get old and break down, windows must be fixed, and so on. Depreciation, as measured in the national accounts, is large, about 16% of GDP. In fact, depreciation is even larger than the national accounts measurement because production is often accompanied by the depletion of natural resources and the degradation of ecosystems. These forms of depreciation logically should be subtracted from GDP, but currently aren't, although there are ongoing efforts to fix this flaw in economic statistics. The second adjustment to move from GDP to national income involves adding the income that the United States receives from abroad and subtracting what it pays to the rest of the world. In the 1950s and 1960s, when international capital markets were shut down, these international flows were negligible. Today, cross-border payments of interest and dividends are sizable. The United States pays 3.5% of its GDP to foreign countries in the form of interest and dividends, and receives the equivalent of 5% of it from the rest of the world. On net, it receives more than it pays. After removing depreciation and adding the net flows of foreign income, U.S. national income reaches about $18.5 trillion in 2019, or $75,000 on average among the 245 million adults, aged 20 and above, who live in the United States. This $75,000 is the same whether one looks at income before taxes and before government transfers, such as Social Security benefits and publicly funded health care spending, or at income after taxes and transfers. Whatever the government takes in taxes, it ultimately redistributes to flesh-and-blood individuals, whether in cash, as is the case of Social Security benefits, in kind, such as when it pays for your health care, or by paying the wages of police officers, soldiers, and other public sector employees. The government, quite fortunately, does not destroy any income, nor does it create any for that matter. The average income of working-class Americans, $18,500. Most Americans earn less than $75,000. Some earn much more. To study income distribution in more detail, it is useful to divide the population into four groups. The working class, people in the lower half of the distribution, the middle class, the next 40%, the upper middle class, the next 9%, and the rich, the top 1%. While these groups are not homogeneous, this simple act of division already reveals stark inequalities. Let's start with the working class, the 122 million adults in the lower half of the income pyramid. For them, the average income is $18,500 before taxes and transfers in 2019. Yes, you are hearing this correctly. Half of the U.S. adult population lives on an annual income of $18,500. Pause for a second and consider the top line of your paycheck before any income tax deduction. We expect many listeners will immediately realize the gulf that separates them from half of their fellow Americans. For 122 million adults, what the market brings in is a grand total of $18,500 a year, about a quarter of the average income of $75,000 in the entire population. This figure is the most comprehensive estimate possible. It is obtained by starting with the broadest possible measure of income, national income, and distributing this total across the entire adult population, leaving nothing out. That $18,500 includes, for instance, dollars immediately paid by workers to the government, in the form of payroll taxes, to take one example, or by their employers to private insurance companies. Further up the pyramid, the next 40%, the middle class, earns $75,000 on average before taxes and transfers, coincidentally, also the average income in the entire population. This group, comprising almost 100 million adults in that sense, can be seen as representative of the country. Though we've all heard doomsday stories about the demise of the American middle class, the reality is more nuanced. With an average income of $75,000, the U.S. middle class is still among the most prosperous on Earth. Moreover, middle class income has grown 1.1% a year since 1980. Which, although nothing spectacular, is not negligible. At a rate of 1.1%, income doubles every 70 years. Newer generations earn twice as much as their grandparents. The striking fact about the American economy is not that the middle class is vanishing, it's how little income the working class makes. What about the people making more than the middle class? When one looks at the top of the income pyramid, it's important to distinguish the upper middle class, the top 10%, excluding the top 1%, from the rich, the top 1%, because these two groups are in entirely different leagues. The upper middle class, 22 million adults, are certainly not to be pitied. With an average income of $220,000 and everything that goes with it, spacious suburban houses, expensive private schools for their children, well-funded pensions, and good health insurance, they are not struggling. But as a group, they do not have much in common with the 1%, the 2.4 million richest Americans whose members make $1.5 million in income a year on average. The gains of the 1%, as large as the losses of the bottom 50%. Since the emergence of the slogan, "We are the 99%, the public has become familiar with the divergence between the fortunes of the rich and those of the rest of society. But the idea bears repeating, because it reflects a fundamental truth about the American economy. Over the last few decades, income has skyrocketed for those at the very top of the income distribution and nowhere else. Some believe that successful, well-off professionals, the top 20% say, have pulled away from the rest of the country. In reality, what the data show is that the main fault line in American society is higher up the pyramid. It is between the 1% and everybody else. Perhaps nothing summarizes more succinctly the metamorphosis of the U.S. economy than this simple illustration. In 1980, the top 1% earned a bit more than 10% of the nation's income before government taxes and transfers, while the bottom 50% share was around 20%. Today, it's almost the opposite. The top 1% captures more than 20% of the national income, and the working class, barely 12%. In other words, the 1% earns almost twice as much income as the entire working class population, a group 50 times larger demographically. And the increase in the share of the pie going to the 2.4 million adults has been similar in magnitude to the loss suffered by more than 100 million Americans. The United States is unique among advanced economies to have witnessed such a radical change in fortunes. Rising income inequality is undoubtedly a global phenomenon, but the speed at which income concentration has been rising over the last four decades depends markedly on which countries you are looking at. Compare, for instance, the United States with Western Europe. In 1980, the top 1% share of national income was the same across the Atlantic, around 10%. In the ensuing years, however, the dynamic of inequality has looked very different. In Western Europe, the top 1% income share has increased by 2 percentage points, instead of 10 points as in America, to reach 12% today. The bottom 50% income share has declined 2 percentage points, from 24% to 22%. Looking more broadly, there is no country among high-income democracies where inequality has increased as much as in America. Everybody pays taxes. Now that we have a good view on how income is distributed in the United States, we can turn to taxes. In 2019, U.S. residents paid the equivalent of a bit more than 28% of U.S. national income in taxes to local, state, and federal governments combined. This corresponds, on average, to around $20,000 per adult. Of course, some pay more than $20,000 and others less, but nobody pays zero. Popular though it may be, the notion that 47% of the population does not contribute to the public coffers, the so-called takers, lambasted by presidential candidate Mitt Romney in 2012, makes no sense. As a country, the United States has chosen to pool close to a third of its resources through its various forms of government. Every adult contributes to this effort. Romney was alluding only to federal income tax, but there are many other taxes to consider when we ask who pays. Broadly speaking, taxes in the United States, like in most other developed countries, can be grouped into four buckets: individual income taxes, payroll taxes, capital taxes, and consumption taxes. Each of these has a fascinating history and plays an important economic role. The federal income tax, created in 1913, is the most well-known and largest tax in the United States, collecting about a third of all revenues, around 9% of national income out of 28%. Although the federal income tax is supposed to draw on all income, whether it derives from working, wages, or owning capital, interest, dividends, capital gains, etc., the income subject to taxation is less than the total amount of national income. Tax evasion contributes to this gap, since statisticians try to approximate the true income of Americans. They include estimates from the sums hidden from the tax man, based on random audits conducted by the IRS to form an estimate of national income. But the main reason why income subject to taxation is less than national income is that many forms of income, especially of capital income, are legally tax-free. Dividends and interest earned on retirement accounts? Tax-free. Undistributed corporate profits? Tax-free. Health insurance premiums paid through employers? Tax-free. The implicit rents that homeowners pay to themselves? The same. Today, income subject to the individual income tax, gross of any deduction, amounts to only 63% of U.S. national income. Most of the rest of national income is legally exempted. Although politicians on both left and right generally insist that it's better to have a broad base, that is, the largest possible pool of money to draw taxes from, the base of the individual income tax has shrunk over the last decades. In 1980, 71% of national income was included in income subject to tax. The unceasing invocations of base broadening notwithstanding, Uncle Sam is taxing a smaller and smaller fraction of the pie. The rates applied to this base ranged from 0% for the first $12,200 of income to 37% for incomes above $510,300, $612,350 for married couples in 2019. This makes the federal income tax a progressive tax. The opposite of a progressive tax is a regressive tax, one where the more you earn, the lower the fraction of your income you must pay. And in between is the flat tax, a tax where everybody pays the same rate no matter his or her income. Though it is progressive, today's income tax is much less so than it has been historically. Since the creation of the federal income tax in 1913, the top marginal income tax rate, the rate that applies to dollars earned in the top tax bracket, above $510,300 in 2019, has averaged 57%, 20 points more than the current top rate of 37%. Besides the federal income tax, all states except 7 impose their own income taxes. States generally use the same definition of what constitutes taxable income as the federal government. They then apply their own rate schedule with top marginal tax rates of up to 13% in California. A few cities, including New York, have their own income tax too. Altogether, these state and local income taxes collect about 2.5% of national income in revenues, making total individual income tax revenues add up to 11.5% of U.S. national income. With the corresponding tax base, as we have heard, at 63% of national income, the average income tax rate in the United States is a bit more than 18%, 11.5% divided by 63%. The second largest source of tax revenue is Social Security payroll taxes, 8% of national income. These taxes are levied on labor earners and come out of a wage earner's paychecks, from the very first dollar earned, at a rate of 12.4%. They are capped at $132,900 a year in 2019, a figure that roughly corresponds to the threshold for being among the top 5% highest wage earners. Any earnings above that cap are exempt from taxation, making Social Security taxes deeply regressive. A separate tax is collected to fund Medicare, the government health insurance program for the elderly, at a rate of 2.9% on all earnings. Altogether, these payroll taxes, which were small 50 years ago, have grown to become almost as large as the federal income tax itself. As we will hear, this development has significantly contributed to eroding the progressivity of the American tax system. The third largest source of tax revenue is consumption taxes. Sales taxes levied by states and local governments, and excises on gasoline, diesel fuel, alcohol, tobacco, etc., levied by both the federal and subfederal governments. License taxes, such as motor vehicle licenses and levies on the extraction of natural resources, also fall into this category, as well as trade tariffs, which are nothing other than sales taxes on imported goods. Altogether, consumption taxes total $3,500 per adult on average. That's equivalent to an average tax of 6% on personal consumption expenditure. Sales taxes represent half of this total, and excises and licenses the other half. In spite of a sharp increase under President Trump, import duties...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.